vibrations in a non-physical, non-mental, universal memory. They self-organize into patterns, and the patterns self-organize into structures via many processes. They form a multi-layered structure which are interconnected, interwoven, and employ many processes themselves and have structures such as senses to interact with the outside pattern, structures within the layers, and so on. And then we saw a typical layered structure, a case study of the layered structure as seen from a human perspective. There can be many configurations of these architectures. The variety is unlimited, but we can find certain features that are common, general, among these layered structures. The first thing that we can observe and logically conclude is that since this is happening by necessity, this will be universal. It will be found everywhere. This is not a one-time occurrence. And there is not just one structure here. There are infinite numbers of them. Given the non-mental and non-physical nature of the memory, given that there are infinite possibilities, there are no limits here. Nothing limits it. So, almost infinite copies are formed, infinite configurations are explored. This is not happening in time, so everything has happened already at once. This is a little bit difficult for a human mind to comprehend, so we make models, we make approximations, and we make pretty pictures to explain and communicate what this is. It should be made clear that nobody really understands what it is. So all I can present to you are very, very logical models of what we see around us based on our own direct experience. So another thing to note, which is a general feature of these architectures, is that there are no sharp boundaries in these layered structures. They dissolve smoothly into each other, and they dissolve into the universal memory very smoothly. The senses are continuous into the layers, and the layers are continuous into the universal memory. It is all mixed at the borders. There are no borders really. So I'm trying to show it here using the blurred picture of the layered structure. And because there are no borders, there is a possibility for the other layered structures to overlap. And because of the self-preservation tendencies of the structure, there is a necessity that this overlap does not cost it in terms of total takeover by other structures. So it evolves boundaries around it. Since there is nothing physical here, the boundaries themselves, they overlap sometimes. So I'm trying to show this by distorting the boundaries of the layers, not only blurring it, where I show that it is trying to maintain a separation from the other structures. The whole of the layered structure tries to preserve itself, tries to survive. It fails, obviously, that is another matter, but as long as it lasts, it tries to maintain this balance of being dissolved in the environment around itself and separating itself from the environment as well as from other structures. So there will be a maxima there where there will be a maximum separation, and the rest where it does not really matter, it is going to let the layers diffuse into surrounding structures. So you will find that the lower layers, they mostly overlap. Like one body is made up of one kind of matter, and there is a possibility that the other bodies will be present there as copies made up of the same matter. And so there is an overlap between the bottommost layer. It is possible that since these bodies are sharing the same environment, the senses are going to perceive the same things, and there will be consensus among these structures. This gives rise to objectivity, where there is agreement regarding to what is being perceived. But it is very costly if this overlap goes above the limited structure of the bodies. And so, due to natural selection, the layers start separating. At some layer, there will be maximum separation where it does not know anything about anything else except itself. Even the senses, they fail to provide any views because the separation is so acute and complete. And at the higher layers, because the survival pressures are not so much, as we have seen in our case study, the non-individualized layers, they don't need to separate themselves. And then again, everything is mixed together at the highest point. It all merges into the universal memory at the highest point, highest layers. So this diagram is very fuzzy, and as usual, we prefer a very clear and sharp drawing so that we can form clear and sharp concepts about it. Otherwise, it becomes very difficult to understand what is going on. So here is a cleaned up structure, which is again showing dissolution at the bottom and topmost layers, but it's also showing narrowing of the structure. Where there is a greatest need of preservation, it is narrowest. So I am separating the other fully formed layers from this one just to make it very clear, and we can entirely get rid of it for a while and check what is happening in this structure from a larger perspective. We are zooming out in the universal memory now. So all the layers have their own processes that are going on, which are shown here with the gear icons. Very mechanical processes there. And there are senses as usual, although this time I'm separating them out from the layer itself, because their job is to gather information about their surroundings. Yes, there will be internal senses that gather information about the layers itself, but I'm omitting it for now. And I've omitted the communication hub also, because we need to keep it neat and clean. So obviously the senses are not going to hang in air outside those layers. They are connected. And very curiously, it can be seen. For example, you can see your five senses. They are hosted in this body. And the body itself is the layer. But the senses can perceive the body. This is really mind-blowing, that the layers that produce the sense can see the layer. However, the senses produce a false image of the layer. The body is shown as an object. The body is not shown as information structure, a structure made up of patterns. And that is impossible, because the senses are not going to function in this way. Their way of functioning is, as we discussed in the previous episodes, that they transform the information into something which is more meaningful for that organism. So when the layers are perceived through one or the other senses, we can give it a name, we call it a body. The body is not necessarily this organic body. This body word is a general word here. For example, the body of your car, the body of your microwave oven, and other structures, which are generally called bodies. The perceived layer is a body. So I am showing these body-shaped figures projecting out of the layer. And there is another name for this structure, which is called the projected body. So the body is a projection of the layer, actually. The body is not the actual representation of the layer. The layer itself will never be seen. And the body is seen to host the senses. There is a body corresponding to every layer, as there are senses corresponding to every layer. So there are traditional names for these bodies, which I'm not going to use in our series because it is all very muddy. I'm just calling it body 1, body 2, body 3, and body N, corresponding to the layers 1, 2, 3, and N. You can choose a name if you want. So usually this body, which is right now, right here in the waking state, will be called a physical body or a gross body, which is hosting the five senses. And actually it is a layer. The layer is being projected as a body. Because the layer itself cannot be seen, the illusion of a body is being created. And that is why we call it a projection of the layer 1. So when seen from the perspective of the universal memory, the body and the layer are almost the same. I said almost because the body is not a perfect representation. But when seen from the point of view of the senses, the layer is seen as a body. And right now, this body, the gross body, has been shaped in a particular format. It has evolved to act in the world. Similarly, there will be other bodies which will have a specific format or form. It will be shown by that sense, or you can say more accurately that it will be perceived by that sense. Because when I say shown, people usually think that I will see it using my physical eyes. That's not possible. Every layer is projected as a body using the corresponding senses only. So in the literature, you will find these words like seeing or feeling, and people think that I'm going to see these bodies using my eyes, but or I can feel them using my hands, which is a total distortion of the teachings. There will be perception of these projections, but not through the gross senses. Why this belief is there? Because people know only the gross senses. They don't know any other of these senses. They have never explored, so they assume things. Those who have explored, they clearly know the meaning of it. And in order to destroy this confusion for once and for all, I'm changing the terminology here. When a book says that such and such named body can be seen using this and that method, it simply means that this projected structure will be perceived using the corresponding sense in that layer. Yes, I've completely removed all the mysticism from this. So now the question comes that these senses, yes, they are projecting the body and so on, but what are they perceiving really? And here comes the structures in the universal memory. Right now, this gross layer, the bottommost layer, with the gross body and gross senses, is perceiving a gross world. I'm calling it the Area 1. The area of the universal mind that is within the grasp of these gross senses is seen as a physical universe, which will be called the Area 1. The layer corresponding to the Area 1 will be the Layer 1. The body corresponding to this area will be the Body 1. And the Body 1 is going to host the suitable senses that are perfectly adapted to Area 1. They see nothing else. They perceive nothing else. We experience nothing else except the Area 1 using the Body 1 and the senses there. This should be very, very clear. So what is the Body 2 hosting the set of senses number 2 in Layer 2 going to perceive? And obviously it is going to perceive another area of the universal mind, which I called it as Area 2, and so on. You can name them if you want. You can be really creative with this, with the corresponding loss of clarity. And it is very, very logical that all other layers will have corresponding areas which they can grasp, which can be perceived by the senses, enclosed in the projected bodies. Remember, the bodies are nothing but the layers as seen through the senses, corresponding to that layer. Yes, I know this can be kind of very new and alien concept, especially for the indoctrined minds. So you can divide the universal memory into N areas corresponding to the N layers, and you will find a set of N senses which are perceiving those areas and only those areas to which they are adapted to. And they see the layer as a body. The senses themselves have a point of view through which the areas of the universal memory are seen as outside the senses, and the layers are seen as bodies. And the senses are seen as hosted in the body. The senses are part of the body, it's because senses are part of layers. But the areas will be perceived as being outside the layer. This is not true. If you go back to the blurred diagram of layers, the layer is perceiving itself. Although, because of the self-preserving tendencies, survival needs, it draws a boundary. That whatever senses are telling me is not me. The individuation happens here. It reaches a maxima in one of the layers. And you can guess which layer is that. If you go back to the previous case study, there is a sub-layer called the identity creator. There, the suppression maximizes. So it can happen at any layer, depending on a specific layered structure. Or you can call it an entity. The entity can be seen as made up of these layers, N layers. Remember the definition of the entity. It is a collection of processes and programs and etc. that displays some kind of intelligence or goal-directed behavior. Now you get a really broad view of what is going on in the universal memory. Not only you got a view of how the layered structure organizes itself, this picture shows you how it interacts with the surrounding structures. What are these surrounding structures? In a typical area, there will be many such separate structures in the universal memory, and I'm going to call them as worlds. So just like in this physical universe, the gross area 1, there are many, many planets neatly arranged in galaxies, although very monotonously. They just spin and spin and spin. These are different worlds corresponding to the gross senses. Why do we call them different worlds? Because there is a virtual separation between the worlds. It takes energy to move from one world to the other world. So the areas will be divided into territories, which will be known as the worlds. So right now, right here, we are in the area 1, in the world number 1, using a body number 1, which hosts the senses corresponding to the layer 1. And this entity extends to the layer N, actually. Why can't I perceive all the layers? Actually, you are perceiving all the layers. There is something called attention, which is focused on only one layer. Because of the immensity of perceptions, the sheer volume of those perceptions, it is not possible to experience all of them simultaneously. They don't produce a meaningful experience if everything is experienced at the same time. As we saw in our previous episodes, the pinhole camera metaphor. So attention is like a pinhole in the camera. It reduces the amount of perceptions. The attention is like sense, you can see. It is like a meta-sense, because the job of the senses is the same. They reduce the amount of information coming in. And attention does it in a more extensive manner. So I'm showing it as a red bar here, which can slide from one layer to the other layer. It is possible to shift the attention to any layer. It is possible to shift the experience from one layer to another layer, from one body to another body, from one set of senses to another set of senses, and not so surprisingly, the areas that are perceived, the change. The experience shifts from one area to another area. This process is called projection. And specifically, we can say that when the attention shifts to a body X, the senses corresponding to that body activate the sense X, and the area X is now experienced. So for those who are wondering, where is the direct experience of all these things? I just gave you the key to experience any of these layers. It is a matter of learning to shift the attention. It is very much within human capability. It's not impossible. Yes, it is difficult. And the difficulty is mostly indoctrination. We are brainwashed into thinking that there is nothing else except this body. The attention need not go anywhere except this body. And so we spend the entire life knowing nothing about what we are, which is this whole of the entity. Enormous amount of experience is possible. Almost infinite amount is possible. Because of our indoctrination, we are denied this opportunity. Imagine billions of people stuck to layer 1, body 1, area 1. Not only area 1, just one world there. Not only one world, just a tiny village or city. They don't even know what this body is. They don't know what senses are. And here I am showing the area of interest of science, whatever common man calls science. Compare it with the whole of the structure. And it is not the whole, actually. I am just showing you one entity here. Compare it with the whole universal memory, and it is like speck of dirt. This is the total area of concern of sciences as we know them today. I am pretty sure this was not the case always. Our knowledge extended beyond this tiny, narrow field. And I am communicating the same knowledge to you. Now, there can be more questions like, how many worlds are possible in a particular area? And because it is virtual, it is an illusion. The worlds get created on demand. New senses, they get created on demand. As we explored in previous episodes, where I described the irreducibles and the secret of the senses. Because there are infinite possibilities corresponding to any area, the senses can choose any experience, and new worlds they keep appearing on demand. So we are going to discuss all these things in greater detail in coming episodes. We are going to discuss all the areas and the worlds and how to actually perceive them, how to learn to shift the attention, how to collect the evidence which supports this model. So now you can see here that the experience corresponding to each layer is almost infinite. And then you can shift the layer and have more infinite experiences. And you can notice here one more interesting thing, that the body sense and the world, it forms a relation. In corresponding to every layer, there is a relation between body sense and the world or the area. So you can derive a law here that it does not matter which part of the universal memory you are in. It does not matter what you are experiencing. There will be these three things always. There will be a body, which is nothing but a representation of the layer you are experiencing. There will be senses and there will be world. This is the law. When I say body, you should remember that it is not the body which you can see in a mirror in the waking state. This body, this structure, the gross body is specific to this area, the area 1. This structure has evolved to tackle the area 1, to function in this world. The different layers, they evolve their own kinds of bodies, which are adapted to their own kinds of areas and worlds. So as it goes more and more subtle, the laws become less and less solid, and the bodies, they become almost shapeless. They can take any shape. They are very fluid, like smoke and clouds. But anyway, they can perceive that areas. At the topmost layer, I mean, I don't know whether that is the topmost or not, but the layer which I call the dissolved layer, there is no body. There is no need of it because almost merge with the area. And I don't think anything specific is perceived there, except simply knowing that I am. That can be called a very pure state. So there is a whole branch of spirituality here, which you just got introduced to, and that is exploration of the universal memory by the means of projection of the bodies of various kinds. That is going to ring many bells for many people who are listening and who have exposure to the occult and esoteric traditions. This is a very big field. This picture is based on explorations of thousands of explorers who are not afraid to explore, who are not afraid to break their indoctrination, who refuse to remain in the boundaries constructed by narrow-minded people. They are free to explore, and they find this kind of self-organized structures everywhere. Now, there is something very interesting here because the layers do not have well-defined boundaries. You see, whatever boundaries I've shown here is only an approximation. It is probably a mechanism that keeps the external influences from entering that layer. That's all it is. But that can be bypassed. You can open the doors of those layers to the external influences very easily. If you know that this layer is not going to be destroyed by that, you can do it. And now, since other entities are in the same memory space, they reside in the universal memory, it is possible to influence the layers in another entity directly. So we all know that one body in the area 1 can touch the other body, can see the other body, and can damage the other body, can produce the other body also, can replicate. Same thing will be possible in all the layers, all the areas. There can be communication between the layers that bypasses the area 1. What do we know? We know only area 1. We know only the body 1. And therefore, I must speak into this mic and you must listen through that speaker, which is in the area 1. That's all we know. But by shifting of the attention, it is possible to communicate with other entities at the level of those layers. Just like it is possible to perceive the surrounding areas, area X, it is possible to communicate with other entity through that layer, entity X. And since the entities, they span these many layers, communication is possible with other entities at all the layers. So it is possible to not only see the gross bodies, it is possible to see the bodies corresponding to other layers, and it is possible to directly communicate with them. That opens up a whole new Pandora's box of phenomena that can be explored here, systematically, rationally, and logically, because this model allows it. What is going on in the layer of the thoughts and abstraction? Oh, I cannot see it. It is in the other mind, you see. Subjective. But this model says that it is simply going on in another layer to which your attention has not reached yet. And because of the barriers due to self-preservation tendencies, this layer is shut down. It won't allow those influences to enter. And so you don't know what is going on in the corresponding layer in the other entity. You know only this one. You know the thoughts of your own layer. But this model provides a direct communication channel between the thoughts of other entities. It is possible. I can remember only my memories. I cannot actually perceive the memory of somebody else, some other entity. And this model allows you to go and actually perceive that, because it shows you that the top layers, they already overlap. There is almost no barrier there. There is no need of survival there. There is no destruction there. No gross matter that can be destroyed. And just like I told you that the causal body is the storehouse of all the memories, it is like a doorway into the universal memory itself. So when you communicate with the causal body of somebody else, you activate it and you can read all the memories. Since it is timeless, remember, it is non-physical, non-mental. You can read the whole past, present and future. These examples are very small examples. We are going to study this in more detail. We are going to see the possibilities of these insights, the new understanding of the bigger picture that we have now. Only sky is the limit. Your imagination is your limit. And then we gather the evidence. First, we predict what is possible using this model. And then we experiment and gather the evidence. The evidence is valid only for the explorer, the seeker. The seeker knows why his subjective experiences. Yes, you can compare notes with each other. And then if there is an agreement, you declare it as objective. Oh, I went to that layer and the area number X and I saw this and this. And you see 10 or 20 more peers, the seekers like you, who are expert in the same field. And they also declare the same thing. Oh, I went to the layer X, I went to the area X, and I saw exactly the same things. And now it is no more subjective, it is objective now. You can see that this is already happening in the case of area 1. Same thing. So it is a valid field of exploration. So we will conclude the discussion on the memory and the layered structures and look into the universal memory in more detail, how the bigger picture looks like. And before we conclude, as usual, I'm going to give you some historical notes, which are just pointers for you to go and explore, find out what happened in the past. So here is the well-known model of a layered structure. This is found in the yogic and tantric traditions. This is the chakra model, where 7 layers are shown, but it is very useful and it was developed to a great extent. Those who are practicing those traditional ways, they know it very well. Although I've seen that there is a lot of ignorance about these things because of all the mysticism and secrecy. Here is another layered model of koshas, which means a chamber, a cell. So kosha is also translated as a body sometimes. So we have the food body and the energy body and the bliss body and so on. But the main point here is that it is a layered model. This is used mostly in the yogic literature. And here we have the kaya system of Buddhism. And there are 3 kinds of bodies are shown here. And this also, this chart also gives you a timeline of how the kaya system evolved. So it was well known since thousands of years that these memory structures, they arrange themselves in layers. And let us take a look at the areas corresponding to these layers, whatever the senses are sensing. So here is a very, very ancient model of the universal memory. And there are very interesting names. And also they have identified the entities that live in those areas. And these areas were called the lokas, which means location, from which the word location and locus, etc. are derived. So you can see 3 major layers. They are subdivided into sub-layers. and their characteristics are given. And they have actually mentioned that all this is happening in a non-local space. The aloka, the space where it is happening, is the lokakash, which is the space of lokas. And the most important thing here is that it is a layered structure. And in the Vedic model, they have 7 plus 7 layers plus, I think, 7 sub-layers corresponding to each layer. And here is the Buddhist model of worlds, again called lokas. So there are 3 major divisions here, consisting of 4 plus 16 plus 11, I think a total of 31 layers. Most obvious thing you'll notice here that it is a layered structure. Probably it is very difficult to pronounce all these very ancient names in long lost languages, but here an attempt was made to translate them. And I found many more models with different names and different counts, but as you can very well guess that these numbers of layers and their names, they are arbitrary. Totally depends on the tradition. So the Buddhist model is very extensive actually. And this one is very interesting from the Santmat tradition. And again, you will find layers and sub-layers in it. Here is the layered model from Hermeticism, the ancient Egyptian knowledge. There are again 3 great planes, and then they are divided into many sub-planes. A plane is nothing but an area. And this one can be called recent. I think it is influenced by the Theosophical Society and all. And it proposes 7 layers with sub-layers in it. And the names are arbitrary as usual. So the layers of the memory and the corresponding areas, they form the greatest picture possible of this illusion. This is something which can be observed through experiments. And in the next part, we are going to explore something which cannot be observed probably and will be purely theoretical. It is about the evolution of the universal memory itself. So stay tuned.